Hi, everybody. Ed Baird here, skipper of Quantum Racing, and today we have the amazing opportunity to sit with Ed Reynolds. Ed is the president of Quantum Sail Design Group and really the team leader for Quantum Racing. Ed, welcome today. Glad to have you with us.
Thanks for having me. You know, I was worried that you guys were never going to get to me. You know, I'm always last, but that's fine.
We save the best for last. You know that. Ed, you're a sailmaker. You're a business owner. You have raced boats. You've watched boats. You've coached people. You've been working in the sport forever. What drove you to get here, and where did you come from originally? I mean, how did you get involved in the sport?
You know, I think I probably have one of the more unique profiles. I mean, I started in the industry when I was 21, and I'd never sailed before in my life. And in all honesty, I was trying to find a way to live in Traverse City. And one thing led to another, and a person told me that there was a sail loft in town. And then honestly, up to that point, it never even dawned on me somebody actually had to make sails. And so I came in, I begged for about a month to get a job. And I don't know, from the very first time I walked into the sail loft, I was just obsessed with it. And they finally hired me. I offered to work for free. Came in with no expectations to get paid. And around one that afternoon, they go, okay, we'll hire you. And so that's where it started, you know, and I just found it amazing. I liked the smell of the loft. I liked the noise, everything a lot about it. I loved being in the sail loft.
Well, that's great fun. And it's certainly not how most people imagine that they would get to where you are in the sport. I mean, you're head of one of the biggest sailmaking companies in the world, a very successful Quantum Sails. And, you know, most people would expect that you went through junior sailing, that you went through college sailing, that you did dinghies, that you slowly got into big boats and then just happened to become a sailmaker along the way somewhere. So really different storyline. But you did a lot of sailing. I remember racing against you. What were the first boats that you used to race?
Well, you know, the local sailors here, you know, here in Traverse City kind of took me under their wing. I mean, I really didn't know how to sail. You know, the thing, as you probably have learned over the years, I'm a little bit OCD. When I'm engaged, I'm really engaged. And as I said earlier, there was just something about this. I couldn't stop thinking about it. I loved every aspect of it. And, you know, I'm way more of a sail maker than probably a performance sailor. I became, I think, a good enough sailor to understand what programs needed, what sailors needed, just kind of work through. But, you know, my goal was never to be a professional sailor. I wanted to be a sailmaker. I wanted to be do this as a business. I wanted that aspect of it. And that's really where I put my energy and my focus. I became a good enough sailmaker that the sailors, a good enough sailor that the sailors wouldn't bag me.
Well, that's important. You know, you've been involved here with the Super Series and the Med Cup before that with the TP52. For the last, well, I mean, it's been 15 years, but certainly the last 10 years that I've been involved with you. What is it about the 52 that drew your attention and got your interest?
Well, you know, it started really when King Juan Carlos and a number of people in Spain started the 52 circuit over there. And, you know, Doug wanted to do it. And so kind of asked, you know, and by at that point in my alleged career, you know, I'd had lots of opportunities. I'd worked with a number of custom programs. You know, I was, you know, I really found my niche as being a manager of subject matter experts, which thankfully for Fred Howe from Warpath fame brought to my attention, because up till that point, I wasn't really sure what I did well. I just liked being there. But That's how we got involved with the 52s. Was Doug wanted to do it, and we put together a program. And I mean, that was in, I want to say, 2005. From then on, it just became this mad obsession with how unbelievable this thing developed, the personnel, every aspect of it. And you know, as I said earlier, you know, I knew I wasn't going to get to the top of the sailing world as a sailor, even though, you know, I have as big an ego as all you guys do. You know, I thought if I really focused on it, I could have done it, but it really wasn't my plan. And but then this just took over. You know, the caliber of the people, the technology, every aspect of it, just being immersed in it. Once again, my obsessions took over.
Well, I feel your pain in that sense, because that's how I feel about the way that the sport goes. You know, we've got a little video that's going to show some of the history of your involvement with the 52s, with the Med Cup, with the Super Series. And while we watch it, why don't you tell us a little bit what we're looking at?
Okay. Ooh. This picture here was a video Keith Brash did that probably put quantum racing on the map. It was the music he put to it was incredible. I mean, that was one of our very first years as quantum racing. That was exciting. You know, the early event, I mean, 2008, I think we ended up having 22 different boats in the fleet that year. It was amazing, the amount of people. Here I'm telling Soapy never to do that again. Miss Universe, when we won in 2008, which probably brought me more notoriety among my friends than anything I've ever done. And just going through, looking at the early Med Cup, it was so exciting. It was just an unbelievable environment. And I think it represented sailing the way all of us really want the world to see sailing. Here we are celebrating. Over the years, we've got to do that a lot. It's been great, amazing teams. You know, Marcelino Botin, who's been our designer forever. Yeah, in most of these, yeah, here I am. There's a picture of me fixing a sail, which nobody believed I knew how to. Skippy, it's just overall team. Boy, this is a walk down memory lane. I haven't seen a number of these in a long time. Team New Zealand, when they came in, you know, they set a standard that then we had to work hard to try to meet again, which, you know, I thought we did a great job of. There's a very happy person there. Yeah, this one, I almost blew a vein out of the side of my head trying to hold that trophy. Nobody told me it weighed about 80 pounds.
That's heavy.
It is really heavy. Here is before, you know, we thought it would be a good idea to hire photographers. They actually had me taking pictures. Amazing memories. Really great. Our IQ technology, Terry, Marty, who is just, you know, you see so many people, a lot of the, you know, you see the sailors, but the people behind the scenes that make this happen for this team, just incredible. Let's see what else. Yeah, I could watch these. I'm just going to sit here and watch. My grandson came where he got to high five the King of Spain. You know, some of the things, the opportunities and the things that, you know, I've been able to do because of this platform is really humbling.
You can see the adjustments over the years. The boats have, you know, slowly gotten a little quicker, a little bit more similar to each other. All the whole fleet now is so close, and you got to fight really hard to do well.
Yeah, you know, it's The problem with it is once you're there and you see the people that do it and you watch the expertise, it almost makes you not want to do anything else. I mean, it is so incredible, the detail. And, you know, what it means to you, and I always have, I'm Grand Prix sailing's biggest fan. Libby would give me grief all the time. Like, first time Warwick Lurie showed up, she goes, "You're like a teenage girl. You are." So, I said, "This is Warwick Lurie. I mean, he's going to actually sail on our boat." And, you know, and when you go through the list of people, yourself, I mean, Terry, it goes across. If you love sailing and you really love, you know, the profiles and the way it's done, this couldn't be anything better. Here I am, the poorest guy at the table. Provessa, Ergen. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
The boats are incredible to sail. They're amazing pieces of equipment, and all the teams are so well put together. You know, it's really fun to just be part of the whole thing. You know, you've been leading this team, and there's been a lot to it. We'll talk about that in a couple of minutes, but you just see, especially what an amazing change over the years in the ability to show how the boats sail. I mean, Keith being able to fly his drone in heavy air and, you know, crazy conditions and be able to get these incredible pictures is really fun and brings that to everybody around the world that wants to see what it's all about.
Well, you know, when we first conceived doing quantum racing, you know, it was never predicated, you know, some of the conversations that, you know, if it was only successful if quantum racing won, then it wasn't a good idea. And what we really wanted to be able to do is to create a platform that, you know, gave people that love sailing a backstage pass, you know, pit row, all those things inside of what professional sailors go through, how they live. And really to the people that love sailing and love to race sailboats could see at the highest level, this is how it works. And when you say that the way it's evolved and the imagery and the things you do, you know, I'm kind of proud because I think quantum racing had a lot to do with that and Keith Brash's efforts. And, you know, so it just so happened that our process was strong and we've really had a lot of success on the race course there. But, you know, it was never the primary focus was to win all the time. We really like it, but the biggest thing, we just wanted people to see what this sport was really like.
Well, I got to say, it's interesting to hear you say that because, you know, certainly the process is very important to all of us. And if you do that well, you end up being successful. But at the same time, when I look back through the seasons, in the last 10 years, for instance, and I'll just look at my notes here, quantum racing in the last 10 years has won 48% of the events that sailed. Now, that's just a staggering number to me to see. And that's with a whole bunch of different people on board, different helmsmen, you know, different tacticians. It's been a really interesting process. 1 year, the team won by 59 points, won the season. There's five world championships in there. And that's just the last 10 years. That doesn't include those first few years that things were getting going with different owners and different boats. So You must have been doing well. And I doubt that you've looked back and calculated that. But the process and the enjoyment that you've brought to the team has definitely made it successful.
Yeah, you know, it kind of created a life of its own, you know, an expectation. And, you know, obviously Doug's involvement, you know, the theory of let's make sure they have everything they they need, not everything they want, because everything the sailors want can be a little tough to do. But let's like make sure we have everything they need and get out of their way. I have to facilitate, you know, a number of times over the years, maybe disagreements, but what was, you know, what has been always so strong is the parallel agenda of everybody on the team. Here's what we're going to, you know, there may be two or three different views of how to get to point A, but it was never, there was never an issue. Everybody wanted to get there. And so, you know, working and making sure from a little bit behind the scenes that we stayed on task, that's probably as much as I contribute to it. And the thing that is so amazing is how proud everybody is on the team. I mean, that one catches me off guard all the time, how they really are proud to be a part of the team. And that part I love.
You do work with a broad range of people. I mean, you know, from billionaires to boat builders and from rookies to relics, you know, you've got us all. You know, how do you herd the cats to get everybody assembled to go in the right direction?
Well, you know, like early on when I first started doing this, I was trying to figure out, well, where is a need that nobody's filling? And this is probably overstated, but, you know, I had been in the business a little while and I was having financial success. I mean, I certainly wasn't getting rich, but you know, I thought of myself as a competent business person. I was a good enough sailor to understand what really good sailors needed to be successful. And this is going to come out sounding weird. There's this weird relationship. It's somewhat adversarial between, and I've got to find a better term for it, the money ego and the talent ego. And they were like rivals, you know, and I figured, you know what, I can be that bridge. And I spent probably most of my career being the bridge of the business side of our clientele would say, well, Ed's a businessman, you know, he looks out for my interest. And the sailors would say, Ed knows enough about sailing, even though he isn't really very good. He knows what we need to be successful. And that's really been my focus. And it's probably the one skill set I feel I've developed over the years that really helps me with a quantum racing team.
Well, the nobody team else does work hard. Well, that's true, I guess. The team does work better every day. And we've got a couple pictures here just to show a little bit of that. The Botine guys are out, you know, have over the years been out working with. You have been personally out to see every single race that this team has ever done. You've been on the water watching and helping. And the next picture is a good example of, you know, what happens when those races crock and we spend time, you know, debriefing it all. I'm sitting there talking with you and the designers, and we're like, okay, the boat's going like this. And they say, okay, we need to adjust that. And it, you know, the whole group is just working consistently on trying to move forward. It's an amazing experience, and we appreciate, you know, how you've been that bridge and helped us all to communicate together. You know, the Super Series is something that and the Quantum Racing team is something that I assume has helped to grow Quantum sales. You know, what's been the main impact on the business side of Quantum sales to have Quantum Racing out doing the Super Series?
Well, you know, everybody in our company really wanted to deal with, I mean, it's the most fun, performance-focused products in the performance end of it. You know, sailing as a, even though one of the people on my board said sailing, there is no sailing industry, but or sailmaking industry, but you know, sailing is a tough one to crack into. It's not overly welcoming to new ideas and new people. You know, people are so, the people that are having success are love it so much, they don't want to put it at risk. So it's not a big risk-taking industry. And it was really hard for us to to convince people we were capable. Quantum racing gave us an international platform. It showed we were successful, that we could compete with the best sailors, best sailmakers in the world. And, you know, and it became, in all honesty, our virtual wind tunnel. We owned the platform, so we got to do some things that, you know, nobody else really in our space was able to do. We tested sails, we got great input, we listened to the sailors, and we did what they asked, and it led us down a path that, you know, I'm incredibly proud of what the company's accomplished, not just in the 52 class, but virtually anywhere we're involved with a performance aspect of sailing. So, you know, I think that part of it, I think the image of Quantum, of that people are familiar with us, I think it'd be hard pressed to say that Quantum Racing, it may not be the forefront of their minds when they think of Quantum, and which I'm completely fine with, because I think all the virtues of what works on that team are exactly what works with the way we run our business.
Good stuff. You know, we've had a, as you mentioned, there's a lot of people who follow the team around the world, and there, you know, I did a little bit of a request out to people to come up with some questions for you for this talk, and I came up with there's a couple picked out of the list. The first one, which I thought was interesting, is you know, what's your favorite role been on all the teams that you've been involved with?
For me personally?
For you personally.
I don't know if there is a favorite. It is just unbelievable. You know, I've kind of filled the same role from day one. I mean, it's unfortunately they never asked me to steer the boat, never asked me to get on and do tactics or navigate. So, you know, almost every day seemed fun. It's something fun. You know, I was looking through the pictures earlier, and almost everyone conjured up a story of something silly or something unique. Just this whole environment. I mean, where I grew up, I never in my wildest dreams ever thought I'd travel all over the world and do this sort of thing at this level with these caliber of people. And, you know, the owner, I have to admit, one of the things that I've enjoyed the most is getting to go to the owner's dinners and meeting the caliber, this clientele, the people that are so interesting and so, you know, I mean, I get so humbled. It's like, gosh, I wish I was as nice as them. You know, their focus and their awareness and the things. I mean, that's been maybe the highlight of almost everything. All the other stuff has been fantastic, and it was the means to an end that we, in all honesty, once we got going, started to expect. But I'm always caught off guard with the new owners and the people that come in, how enlightening that is getting to know them.
There's another more serious racing question that came through, which is a little bit about just the number of hours, the number of actually years that you have spent on the water around people racing. And it's a good question. It was, you know, what do most sailors need to do better in your eyes?
Well, you know, this is horrible, but I've been doing this now 40 years. My obsession is an obsession. It just happens. I think, you know, the biggest thing, first and foremost, boat speed is everything. I think focusing on boat speed. The other thing that I think most sailors have to be is incredibly honest goal setting with their crew and their team. And the honesty comes with, here's what we can do and here's what we can't do. And, you know, I've always used the analogy of, like, if you're a baseball player and you want to get into the Hall of Fame, you know, you got to be able to hit for average. You got to be fast. You're a good fielder, good arm, hit with power. You know, if you can do all five of those things, you go to the Hall of Fame. Well, sailing's the same thing. You've got to start. You've got to boat handle. You have to sail handle. You have to do tactics. And you're not going to be great at all of them. And so, you know, the biggest thing that I see, and I know a few people are just sick of me ranting on about it, is the risk management aspect. Do what you do well, minimize your risks. You don't ever have to be the fastest boat. Your basement is way more impactful than your attic in sailing. Be average a lot. Boat.
It never hurts to be the fastest boat. So we got another question. And I think you maybe know where this came from. What is your favorite sail?
My favorite sail? Well, there really is only one sail, and that would be the staysail. It's the workhorse of the sail inventory. And, you know, I get a lot of grief because people are just jealous because I am the avowed world expert on staysails. And it's something I take seriously. And obviously the staysail.
Okay, fair enough. And for those of you that don't know, this is a little bit of an inside joke within our team that, you know, as much time as we spend looking at mains and jibs and kites, the staysail, it can be a sail that makes a huge difference to your performance on the race course. And Ed always reminds us that how important staysails are, and make sure you get that little sail really well, correctly done, you know. So thank you for for that. There was one that came in. Yeah, I know it's your mission. It's been great. Now there's another question that came in that I'm going to answer for you, if you don't mind terribly, because I know what the answer is. And the question was, what's your favorite quote? And I know what that is. What that quote is one of the greatest things I've ever heard. After, you know, a tough race, maybe we have a bad start, or we do something stupid and go the wrong way, or we can't do a boat handling maneuver and lose several boats. And then somehow, just at the end of the race, we're able to scrape back in and do okay, maybe finish fourth out of the 15 boats or something. And you came by and you said, well, some fourths are better than others. You know, and I will always remember that on the race course. If we'd have been third the whole race and dropped back into fourth, we'd all been upset. But the fact was, we were 10th all race, and we just moved into fourth right at the end, and that was very exciting. And you're right. But maybe there's another quote that you think of as your favorite. I don't know.
I think that's a handy one. And, you know, after the race, driving up with the chase boat to the boat, it's like a precarious time. You know, it's, if we had a great race, we'd do those. Or, you know, sometimes, and just, you know, I'm sure there's experts in body language. We should bring them out on the boat and just show the different body language of everybody on the boat after a good race, after a bad race. It's, I'm sure it would contribute to society.
I'm sure you're right. So, changing the subject slightly, you know, we have another picture that I think you mentioned just a little bit earlier is a special moment. And you know, Quantum Sails has worked hard to make an effort to bring young sailors into the sport, but I've never seen this level of support. I mean, you know, tell us what we're looking at right here.
This is one of my all-time favorite memories of being involved with the 52. What's fun, this is my grandson, Alex. And it was interesting because we were having a pretty good regatta. We were coming into the last race. And I said, you know, if we win this race, you're going to meet the king. Tonight, you know, well, you can go up on stage with us. And he's like, oh, you know, kind of excited. And then all of a sudden I noticed he was really worried. And you know, I don't know if I want to do it. And, you know, we kind of talked about it. And I can't remember who it was on the team. But I mentioned to him, I go, yeah, I'm surprised. Alex is so nervous about the fact that, you know, he doesn't want to go up on stage with us to meet the king. And I said, well, you idiot. The only king he can picture is that Burger King guy. So he thinks he's going to go up on stage and meet the Burger King king. It's like, okay. So I had to explain that to Alex. So, but what was amazingly cool, I think that picture was the first public appearance for King Philip after he took over for his father. And the media was unbelievable. And I didn't even look behind us, but we walked up on stage. And what was so amazing is the king saw Alex and went directly over to him and asked him, he said, are you going to high-five me? And Alex said, sure. So he high-fives the king, and he holds his hand for like about 30 seconds and carries on a conversation. And he tells him, he goes, I know this team. There's no way they could have won this without you. You should get the trophy. And then we turned around, and there must have been 200 photographers all snapping pictures. It's one of the greatest moments of my life.
Well, good fun. And, you know, you guys do a lot for bringing people into the sport. It was not a joke about that, but it was great to have Alex there and to have the king just get excited about seeing us and seeing him. Another thing that you guys do is you've got a terrific award that you give to the Women's College Sailor of the Year. And I think we've got a picture of the past winner. Tell me about the concept there. You know, you're supporting college sports, but you're not really, the college sailors don't buy a bunch of quantum sails. And, you know, what's the program there?
Well, you know, as I said earlier, you know, trying to fight our way through with quantum to establish ourselves, you know, there weren't a lot of people out there paving the way for us. You know, a lot of it we had to do ourselves. And, you know, and being really sensitive to the point of how do we get sailing more diverse? How do we create more opportunities? And, you know, we had done a lot of work with Collegiate Sailors of the Year, and it would just came when, why isn't there a female Collegiate Sailor of the Year? So for us, you know, and, you know, we're trying to build our company is to become more diverse. I mean, we have a great women staff within the company. And, you know, we just thought it was really important that women get recognized. And I mean, it wasn't altruistic on our side, it was just time. And so for us, it's the highlight. One of the highlights of the year is when the Women's Sailor of the Year gets awarded. And, you know, it's been really, really rewarding to see quotes from past winners. And they refer to the award as, well, you know, the year I won the quantum, you know, it's like, yes, you know, so that's been exciting. And, you know, you're just seeing really amazing women in the sport, and not just sailing, you know, in the business side of it. And yeah, for us, it's really important. And we want to, you know, on our mission statement, one of the lines is, you know, we don't believe there's any wrong way to love sailing. And however you want to do it, we want to help and be a part of it. But it has to include, it's got to get more diverse than it is right now. And we're hoping we're helping.
Good stuff. Well, just slightly changing the subject back to quantum racing again. You know, this year was tough with the virus and shutting down all the events around the world. And we only got to just barely get started before everything shut down. What's the future look like? What's the plan for the Super Series?
Well, I think the Super Series is going to be stronger than ever. You know, right now, probably the biggest limiter to growth is inventory. You know, we're kind of waiting to see exactly what happens long term with the America's Cup. Is there any symbiotic relationship that could happen with future cups going through. So we've frozen the rule through 2021. But at that point, if we had five more world-class boats, we'd have five more teams in the circuit. I'm incredibly proud of what the staff and the team around the Super Series has put together. The recognition, it truly is just an unbelievable platform for sailing, and especially it's a positioning for where the pro sailors really can be pro sailors. I mean, they sail with the best equipment under the best conditions. I think if we, there's some hesitation to build a new boat now because, the worry that you'd get 2 years and the rule would change. I think that's not really going to happen, but I'll be surprised if over the next couple of years, the biggest limiter, we're going to have to limit who can participate in the Super Series because we won't be able to fit enough boats into the venues. So I'm really excited about it, and I think it fulfills everything we set out to try to do with the circuit.
Well, I think this, I hope you're right. It's certainly a great place to race boats, and the teams are amazing. Quantum Racing has been an amazing experience for me, and I think we're going to wrap things up here with you and say thank you, but I really do want to express the thanks of everyone who sails on the Super Series for you and the others that run that event, that manage that event, for how hard you've worked to make it such a great circuit. And then, of course, a tremendous thanks to all of us who sail on Quantum Racing for your long, long time support of that team. And we're glad that it works for you. We appreciate being able to be on the team with you. And today, it's been fantastic to get to know you a little better and for people to come and hear about your past and some of the things that make you excited. And so we want to say thanks for coming along.
Thanks for having me. And I'm the beneficiary more than anyone else of the impact that it's had on me, the friendships I've made in it. Wow, who gets to live a life like this?
Great stuff. Ed Reynolds, thank you so much. See everybody on the water soon, and have a great day. We'll be right back.